For today now, we're now gonna look at the other parallel join algorithm to do sort merge. So again, just as a reminder, where we're at in the semester is that we're looking at all sort of the things you need to do to run fast analytics. So Tuesday's class was about doing parallel hash join. Now today's is how to do parallel sort merge join, which again is the second other major join algorithm you can have. But as we saw last class, and we'll see here today, hash join is pretty much what you're always gonna want to use. So today we're gonna start off talking about the background about SIMD and sort merge, and then we'll focus on how to do the parallel sort merge algorithms. There's one in the paper you guys read, but then we'll also cover the one from the guys developed at Hyper. And then we'll have this evaluation that sort of compares these different algorithms plus throw in hash joins, and you'll see why the hash joins will be better. So just as a spoiler for this entire lecture, everything we're going to talk about and everything you guys read doesn't actually work for current Xeon CPUs. So when I say Xeon, I mean literally like the Intel Xeon CPU, not the Xeon Phi coprocessor or the Xeon Phi processor. For whatever reason, they want to reuse the name Xeon. There's the Xeon general purpose CPUs. Again, that's what you think of when you think of a server machine, but then there's also the Phis, which we'll cover next week. So everything doesn't work on the CPUs you buy from Newegg to run on your server. And I'm not going to tell you why as we go along, but we'll see if anybody picks up why this doesn't work at the end. Okay? So now that you may be thinking, why did I have you read a paper that doesn't work? It's because that eventually this will work, and eventually this actually might make the sort merge joins faster than the hash joins. But we're not quite there yet on general purpose CPUs. Right, so everyone here probably should already know what SIMD here is. Has everyone taken 418, 618? Right, you cover that stuff here. So SIMD stands for single instruction multiple data. And it's there are a class of these CPU instructions that are gonna allow a application to have the processor invoke the same instruction multiple times simultaneously in parallel on different pieces of data. Right, and so this is different than what we normally think of when we think of writing programs in terms of SISD instructions, or single instruction, single data item. And this comes from Flynn's taxonomy of CPU architectures from the 1960s. Right, so this idea has been around for a while, and it's only maybe the last 15, 20 years have database systems actually start to employ these, use SIMD for these techniques. So the idea has been around for a while, but it wasn't really until like the 1990s that like AMD and Intel started including SIMD instructions or extensions to their microarchitectures. Right, so when it first came out in the 1990s, Intel called their thing MMX, AMD called their thing 3D Now. I remember when I was like in middle school, we had a Pentium CPU in the 90s, and it was a big deal for us to get MMX. We didn't know what it meant. Most programs didn't actually use it, but Intel was very good at marketing that you needed to have SIMD, even though nobody knew what it actually was. So in these early incarnations of SIMD on Intel's chips, they were actually pretty bad, right? So the problem was, whenever you invoked a SIMD instruction, it would block the CPU from running regular instructions, right? It's only a small little blip, but actually it'd make a difference because you can't run things in parallel. The later versions were the SSE, SSE2, and SSE3. These sort of added support for doing these instructions in parallel with the CPU while it did other things, because it would have better support for out-of-order execution. And then now where we're at today, for the most part, when people talk about SIMD, they talk about using AVX2, 56, or 512. Right? So we'll cover what these different SIMD instructions do next week when we talk about vectorized execution. So I'm only bringing this up now because you need to understand SIMD to understand how they're going to do hardware accelerated sort merge, the hardware accelerated sort merge join. So just at a high level to see what SIMD looks like, say we want to do this operation x plus y equals z, and where x and y are these vectors of integers, right? And so the output of this summation is another vector of just taking the values of x1, y1, and producing them there and going across for all of these. So the way you would write this in your program normally is you would just implement this as a for loop that would iterate over the every element of the two vectors, and you assume that they're the same size, and then you're just going to add them together and then write them out to another vector, which is the output buffer. So to do this with SysD, right, the single instruction, single data item, what happens is you're basically just going to iterate through every single element and add them two together and then write them out to the buffer here. Right? Again, it's called SysD because you have two data items, right? And you're going to invoke a single instruction on them. It can't combine multiple of these things together. So now with SIMD, how it's different is that instead of looking at individual elements, what you're instead going to do is take a run of elements or multiple elements from the two input vectors and then store them in this memory aligned register, the SIMD register here. Right, so for this, the top one X, we'll take the first four elements, store that in one register, and then take the next four elements and store this in another register. So the way to think about how this would work in your program is these SIMD registers are sort of like these variables that you can write in data into. Right? And the way you write this code is that you use the same kind of CPU intrinsics that we talked about before, where the compiler would then just translate them into the actual underlying instructions to do the load and store to write data into these registers. So now the key thing about this is that the register is always going to be a fixed size, right? It'll be 100, and in this case here, it's 128 bits. In the newer ones, you can have 256 bits. So that means that you can only store, a finite number of elements in the registers. So in this case here, we're storing 32-bit integers, so we can store four 32-bit integers in a 128-bit register. And we need to be careful that we make sure everything aligns correctly. In this case here, we're only doing numbers or integers, so it's really simple. So now that what happens is once we load these four elements into this SIMD register here, then we just invoke the single SIMD instruction that will then go add the first element from the top with the first element from the bottom and so forth to then write out the result as a single vector. So what happens in the way this works is it ends up also getting written to another SIMD register that's going to be the same 128 bit size as this one here. And then eventually, if we want to then use this in our program, we then have to copy it out of the register and put it into memory. And again, we use intrinsics to do this movement of data around. So then now for the remaining elements in our two arrays, we do the same thing. We copy them out into our registers, invoke the SIMD instruction, and then we produce our final output. All right, so before, when I showed the SysD example, we had to do eight additions to walk through every single element. In this case here, I only have to do two addition instructions. But because they can process multiple data at the same time, right, that's much more efficient, much more quick. So we're getting a 4x speed up in terms of the number of instructions we have to execute when we use SIMD versus SysD. Now, you do have to execute instructions too to move the data out from memory, from L1 or whatever, into your SIMD register. But you have to do that same thing anyway to do the addition, because you have to move it out of your memory down to the addition registers. So even though it sort of looks like it's an extra copy to move the data from the memory into the register, we do that anyway for SysD as well. So this sounds amazing, right? This sounds like this is going to be a big win for us. And as we'll see in the lecture today, you can get quite a significant performance improvement if you use SIMD correctly. The tricky thing, though, is that not all algorithms can be easily vectorized. And furthermore, the most common compilers are not also very good at vectorization. So that means that we, as the database developer, the people that actually are building the database system, we have to be versed in how SIMD works, and we have to be responsible for recognizing that this algorithm can be vectorized and what SIMD instructions to use. Because the compiler, for the most part, is not going to be able to do this automatically. There is a compiler from Intel called ISPC. I forget what it stands for. Or Intel's SMPD compiler. And this is actually very good at finding opportunities to do vectorization. But for most part, it can only handle sort of simple things. For the complex algorithms that we're talking about here, like joins, and next week you'll read a paper where they do vectorization for every single possible relational operator, so aggregations, scans, and everything. For those things, the scans maybe, for other things, the compiler is not going to be able to figure this out for us. So we have to do this ourselves. We also have to be careful about making sure that our data aligns correctly in the register. Right? So that means if I have, say, like a 48-bit integer for whatever reason that I want to add together, that's going to be problems when I put it in the SIMD register, because it wants to look at 32-bit integers from two different registers and add them together. It doesn't know how to go over that boundary. So for the most part, for everything we'll talk about here, and in general in database systems, this is not really going to be a problem, because when we have to do a join to do tables or sort keys in the same table, it's always going to be the same type. They're always going to be the same fixed length. If it's a varchar, then we just use dictionary encoding to get a 32-bit or 64-bit integer. So this is not really a problem for us in databases, but in general, this is a big deal in SIMD. Another tricky aspect of this, too, is getting the data into the correct form inside the registers, and then getting it out in the correct form that we need it is actually going to be tricky and non-trivial to implement. For the example that I showed here with the SIMD addition, it's really easy, right? You just take the values in, then they get written out after the addition in the form that we're going to need it for whatever else we want to do. But for other operations, as we'll see later when we talked about the sort networks, you have to do some extra shuffling to move things around. Now, the nice thing about SIMD is that you can have the SIMD registers write to other SIMD registers. So it's not like we have to go back and forth between L1 and the SIMD registers when we want to do this movement. But you have to be mindful of what you're actually doing to put the data into the correct form, because if you do everything in L1, it's going to be slow. We'll see this again more next week when we talk about the paper from the guys at Columbia, where they show how to do vectorization for all different types of algorithms. There's actually going to be certain instructions that Xeons aren't going to support, and therefore they have to be emulated on the CPU, which then will slow down your algorithms, where again the Xeon Phi might actually have, the newer Xeon Phis have those instructions. So again, we'll talk about more about this later on, but you'll see a glimpse of this when we talk about how to do SIMD for the sort networks. All right, so now you may be thinking, like, given what I just showed you about this SIMD stuff, why don't we actually want to use the GPU? Because the GPU is sort of like SIMD on steroids, right? You can have a ton of sort of smaller cores all doing the different kind of processing that we want to do in parallel. And in general, what I'll say is that most database systems, almost every single database management system, does not actually support GPUs, because moving the data back and forth from the CPU memory, like in DRAM or your CPU caches, down to the PCI Express bus, where the card actually is really, really slow. And so you're better off just doing whatever it is you want to do in the CPU, because the time it takes to send the data down then send the data back up is actually going to take much longer. So in general, most database systems don't use GPU. Now, there are some newer database systems that have come out in the last couple of years that do use GPUs. And actually, MapD just announced yesterday that they raised $25 million in a Series B funding. So that's pretty significant. But there's also this Scream, or however you want to say that. It's another streaming database. And then Kinetica used to be called GPUDB, and they renamed to that one here. So these are systems where they claim that they can use the GPU to sort of accelerate query processing without having to pay the big penalty of having to go back and forth over the PCI Express bus. The way MapD does this actually is you just load the entire database onto your GPUs, right? And then you do all your queries as sequential scans down there. But if we have a database that we've been talking about where we want to support hybrid workloads where the database is being updated and we want analytics on it, then GPUs aren't going to work, because it's going to take too long for us to propagate the data, the changes down to the GPUs. So these are mostly used in analytical systems where the database is static. Again, we'll talk more about GPU acceleration next week. In general, it's not quite the way these guys are doing it. It's not quite what I think is the right way to do it for hybrid workloads. It's just simply not going to work. Now, what actually might be a big game changer are these newer coprocessors that are coming out, where the GPU or the really vectorized hardware is actually directly on the socket with the regular CPU, and it's cache coherent. So that means like the GPU running on the socket can access memory, the same memory that the CPU sees, and everything is in sync. Then you don't have to go back and forth between the PCI Express bus, and that's going to allow you to do a lot of interesting things. So AMD has this thing called APU. Intel has this Knight's Landing thing, which is sort of a coprocessor. I think the newer versions of Intel's hardware is going to have more stuff on the sockets, right? They bought that one startup, Nervana. They want to put like sort of deep learning things directly on the socket. So when these things come out, some of the things we'll talk about today, you can actually maybe push to a GPU, and that'll run faster than SIMD. But then you can do this without having to avoid copying things back and forth between the GPUs. Okay, we'll talk more about this next week. But I just wanted, like, this came up last time. Like, anytime we talk about vectorization, people are always like, well, can a GPU do this? And the answer is yes, but it's slow to move data. All right, so for now to get into the sort, merge, join algorithm. Again, we covered this in the intro class. The algorithm is really, really simple to understand. You have in the sort phase, you basically just sort the inner relation and the outer relation on the same key that you're trying to join them on, the same attributes. And then in the merge phase, you just scan through the two tables sort of in lockstep, and you just do the comparison between the tuples from the two sides. Right? And you know that in the case of the outer relation, you never have to backtrack to go look at tuples you've already sort of examined. You can sort of walk through the outer table in order, and in the inner table, you just sort of do your comparison, and you sort of know how to whether you should move one cursor versus the other based on what the values are you see when you're joining them. So in the case of, again, for the merge phase, we only have to scan the outer relation once. The inner relation may need to backtrack if we have duplicates or foreign keys and other things. So visually, at a high level, it looks like this. Right? So we have our two relations. Say these colored bands or different variations of gray represent the different values that we want to join them on. So in the first phase, you do sort. So now you have these sorted bands like this. And I'm not saying what the sort algorithm is. For our purposes, it actually doesn't matter. In general, it's usually quick sort, but you could use heap sort. You could use the hybrid sort that the SDL uses. It doesn't matter, right? Because we're assuming everything's going to be in memory. Then in the merge phase, again, you have two cursors on the outer relation and the inner relation, and then it just knows how to walk through this and do the comparison going across. And if the join keys are equal, or whatever the predicate you're using for your join evaluation, then you produce it in the output buffer or for the result of the join. Right? It's pretty straightforward to understand. So now when we throw in the parallel sort merge, the key observation that we can make, and the thing that we're going to spend all our time on, is how to speed up sorting. Because that's going to be the most expensive part that we have to deal with, or most expensive phase in our algorithm. And just like in the hash join algorithms we talked about before, we want to be mindful of what the hardware is going to look like to allow us to make decisions about our algorithms we're going to use to do the join so that we get the maximal performance and making the best utilization of our hardware. So that means that we want to make sure that all our CPUs are sort of running at full blast, always have data to process, never stalled on cache misses or waiting to get things back from DRAM. And then we also need to be mindful of our NUMA boundaries, just like before, because we don't want to have one core running at one socket get data that's far away at another socket, because then you got to go over the bus and then pull that over, and that's going to be slower, as we saw before. So we'll see in one case, actually, in the case of the hyper guys, they sort of violate this when they do the actual merging of the sort merge algorithm, because they claim they're doing sequential writes and doesn't matter, or sorry, sequential reads, and it doesn't matter whether the data is not local to it. The hardware prefetcher will sort of hide all this latency from it. So now the parallel sort merge join algorithm is just like in the hash join. It's the same basic algorithm, but there's this optional partitioning phase where we want to split up the outer relation into disjoint subsets or segments. You call them morsels, call them partitions, shards, the same thing. And we're going to assign them to different workers or cores. And that way, when they get into the sort phase, most of the data that they have to process will be local to it. Right? This is entirely optional. We saw in the last class that actually doing this step, doing radix partitioning for the hash join, actually was not always the best idea, especially when the data was skewed. So that's sort of, we have that same sort of edict here. We may not always want to do this step. right? Then the rest is all the same, right? We're going to do our, we sort the outer and the inner in the same key, and then we just do that iteration over to over the two tables, and do the comparison to see whether we have a match. So I'm not going to say much about the partitioning phase here. It's again, the same radix partitioning that we talked about last class is applicable here. We can do the exact same thing. We also can rely on the fact that our data might already be implicitly partitioned when we loaded it in, as it was in the morsels case, right? So implicit partitioning is that you figure out what key you want to use to split your tables up when they get inserted, and you assign them to the different NUMA regions. So in the case of the, again, for the explicit partitioning part, everything we talked about last class is game here. So there's not really anything else extra to say here. So again, we'll spend most of our time on the sort phase. So the goal of the sort phase, at a high level, what it's doing is that it wants to produce what are called sorted runs on chunks of data for the two relations you're trying to sort on. Right? So a run is sort of, again, think of it, some string of tuples that are all sorted from lowest to highest. And we're going to do this in sort of small parts and then slowly build them up to be more larger sorted runs until we get to the final point where the entire table or the entire subset of the data that we need to access for our join algorithm has been entirely sorted. So as I said before, when we do the basic sort merge algorithm, quick sort was good enough. Quick sort is really fast. Right? So there's not really anything, when you're not worried about having extra cores or worried about NUMA, your NUMA regions, quicksort is good enough. But everything we're going to talk about here are going to be replacements for quicksort that will get better performance because we'll take advantage of the hardware and we'll be mindful of where the data it is that we're reading and writing so that we avoid cache misses and we avoid having to go over the interconnect bus. So the algorithm I'm going to show you comes from they referenced it in the paper you guys read from the ETH guys, but it actually comes from an earlier paper from Intel and Oracle in like 2009, where they developed this technique called cache-conscious sorting. And so the way to think about cache-conscious sorting is the sort is actually being done in sort of multiple phases or at multiple levels. The data is going to move between multiple levels. So this is not the language that they use in the Intel paper, but this is sort of how the way I like to think about it, the terminology that I like to use to understand what's actually going to go on. So in the first level, what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to generate sorted runs that can fit in the CPU SIMD registers. So in the case of the example I showed before, we're going to generate runs that contain just four values or four elements. And we're going to do that until we sort the entire data set. And then we'll go now to the second level, where now we're going to combine together the sorted runs from the first level into subsequently larger and larger runs, up until till they're the half the size of our L3 cache. Right. So in the first phase, again, we have four elements, so it's 128 bits. And then when we go to level two, we'll take two 128-bit runs. They'll combine together to be 256, then we'll take two 256 runs and combine them for 512 and so forth. And we'll keep doing this until the size of our sorted runs are half the size of our CPU caches. And we think, I guess, why they have to be half the size. Yes? Exactly, yes. You need to store the input and the output in your CPU cache, so it has to be half the size. Right? Because you can't do in place sorting here. So you keep going until you reach that halfway point, or half size point. And then you switch into level three, where now you do out-of-cache sorting. And this is where you're going to make runs that are going to be larger than your CPU caches. But you can't avoid this, because if the table is going to be larger than your CPU caches, you have to go into DRAM. So we'll see how they handle this and make sure that the CPU is sort of running full utilization and you're not and you're saturating your memory bandwidth. All right, so again, the sort of pictorially, it looks like this. We start off with our unsorted data set. And then in level one, we'll break this up into our four elements runs that can each fit into a SIMD register. And then at level two, we just sort of start combining these into larger and larger sizes. And then in level three, we'll make the larger runs until we finally produce the complete sorted run, which is just the entire input relation. All right, so I'll go through each of these steps one by one and show you how they actually implement it with SIMD. All right, so for the first level, they're going to use a technique what's called sorting networks. So sorting networks are actually a really old idea. I think they come back, they came out like in the 1940s, right? People sort of proposed having this type of hardware. And the way to think about sorting networks is that, think of it as like this hardware device where you have these wires that can hold a value. And you're going to pass them along the wire until you reach a comparator, where you'll compare two wires' values together, and then they'll produce an output that then is carried along further on the wire. So say, for an example here, say we have four elements, right? Because we're doing a 128-bit SIMD register. We have four elements. And so along these wires here, this thing will carry the value 9, this will carry 5, 3, and 6. And then these vertical bars represent the comparators. Well, we'll take the value from the bottom wire and the value from the top wire, and we'll just run a min-max comparison on the two of them. And what will happen is the lowest value, the min value, will be moved to the top, and the max value will be moved to the bottom. Right? So do the same thing here. So then, now after this comparator along the wire, this wire will carry the value 5. So then that gets fed into this next comparator, where we compare 5 and 3, and obviously 3 is less than 5, so 3 gets put up here, and then it gets moved all the way to the output. So at this point, after this comparator, there's no other comparator that comes along, so the value can then be written to our output slot here. And we know that 3 is always going to be the min value. Same thing going along for these wires here, 9 and 6, which produces 6 and 9. 9 doesn't have any more comparisons, so it goes to the bottom here, and then we compare 6 and 5, and we produce 5 and 6. Right? So this is pretty straightforward to understand. What's actually really fascinating about this, right, is that this is super fast to actually implement. You may be thinking, well, how useful can this actually be, because you can only compare four numbers, right? But again, remember saying we're going to do this for all these little four-number chunks that can fit in our SIMD registers for the entire data set, and we can implement this really, really fast. Because unlike quicksort and other sorting algorithms, there's no conditionals at this at all. We can implement this entirely with SIMD instructions. There's no if clauses whatsoever. Like in quicksort, there's if branches, right? And if you have an if branch, then you may do an unexpected jump and flush out your instruction pipeline, which then that's really slow to do on a superscalar CPU. So in this case here, we can implement all these min-max operations for comparator with just two SIMD instructions to produce our output. So, and no matter what the values are we have here, the execution path of the program is always going to be exactly the same. Because we're always going to first execute this thing, and then execute that one, and then from there we can execute this one. So it's not like we would execute this followed by this. We always know exactly what the instructions are going to be. So sort of think of this as like we can unroll the loop to do this and just execute them in always the sequential order. So let's see how to do this with SIMD. So for this, what I'm going to do is we're going to sort four element vectors. Right? So each of these are a SIMD register, and they can hold four values. And so what we're going to do is we're going to first load the data out of memory into our SIMD registers. So that's just four load instructions. That's really cheap. So then now we're going to sort across registers. So that means we're going to sort this column here rather than within the register itself. And this is because the way SIMD works is you can't do like addition or min and max or whatever the operation you want to do. You can't do it within the elements inside of the SIMD, inside of the register. You have to do it across registers. So we're going to sort this column here. And we can just do that doing the sorting network that I showed before, because we know exactly what the min-max instructions we want to execute are. So to do this, to sort this these four registers, we only need to do 10 min-max instructions to sort all these guys. So now you see again in this column, now this is sorted. But the problem is when we want to write this out, we don't write out the column, right? We have to write out the register. So if we did that, if we just dump these registers out into our CPU caches, then do the transformation, that would be really slow now because that would be SISD instructions to do this and with extra mem copying. But because when I said you can do SIMD operations, that the SIMD operations produce output that goes into other SIMD registers, I could do all the transformation I need to put this in the form that I want directly all in SIMD. I never have to copy anything out into L1. So to do this, I do a transpose where now 8, 11, 14 are now all aligned together in a single register. And now for each of these registers, it's not globally sorted, right? Certainly 8 is less than 9. So you can't read this, you know, sort of good from this and this and this and this. You can only sort it within the single register itself. But now I can write this out into DRAM, into my program's memory, without having to do any additional operations. It's in the form that I want. So now to do this, this is only 8 shuffle operations, and then it's 4 store operations to then write them out to memory. So we went to sort 16 numbers all within SIMD is only less than 24 instructions. There's no way quicksort is going to be this efficient. All right, so this is why SIMD, you know, using the hardware, using the acceleration that SIMD provides, we can sort these little runs very, very quickly, much faster than you can do with quicksort. All right, so now once we do this for all the elements, and now we have these, you know, a bunch of these different 128-bit vectors or 4 element vectors, we then want to go to the second level where we want to start merging together 2 locally sorted lists, like 2 locally sorted 4 element lists, to now produce a globally sorted list. And we keep doing this until we reach these globally sorted lists are half the size of our CPU caches. And to do this, we're going to use a technique called the Bitonic Merge Network, which also, again, came from the SIMD version of doing this is in that Intel paper from a few years ago. So I think this is actually really fascinating, what they talk about in this paper. I think this paper has one of the, you know, makes a really large scientific contribution for what they were able to achieve using taking existing algorithms that we've known about for a long time and speed them up on hardware. So in this paper, they talk about how they can speed up their sorting algorithm by up to 3.5x over the sort of traditional SISD implementation. And this is actually really, really significant because if you think about it, quicksort's been around since like 1970s. Right? There's no magic, you know, as far as we know, that's gonna make this go, you know, immediately faster unless like P equals NP, right? So by taking the same algorithms that we've known about but using hardware in a more intelligent way, you can get a 3.5x speed up over sort of a naive implementation. That's quite significant. And so that's why I think this paper is really important. And it's definitely, if you're interested in this kind of stuff, you should definitely check it out. Except, as we'll see later on, it doesn't actually work. So, all right. The way the Bitonic stuff works is that it looks a lot like the sort networks where you have these wires that are passing in values. And then you have these comparators that produce more values. But now the input for us is not going to be single elements that we did in the level one. They're actually now going to be the sorted runs produced from the first level. Yes?
The paper specifically talks about the shuffle instructions in the SIMD registers making it a little bit slower and not achieving the 4x speedup that you spoke about initially. I just wanted to know, since you said that you have less than 2 dozen instructions, but then each instruction is not equally in terms of execution time as such. The shuffle instructions take actually more time. So, like, in terms of that, compared to like the quicksort you mentioned, how much does the shuffle actually cause a slowdown, and is there a way to speed up the shuffle, or like how does the shuffle slow down basically?
All right. So I think your question is back here. Yeah. So his statement is, which he's right, doing shuffles on SIMD, though, is not going to be that much more expensive than doing MiniMax. So his statement is, all these instructions that I'm showing you, they're not all equivalent, right? Doing a MiniMax with SIMD registers is potentially cheaper than shuffle.
I mean, the paper specifically talks that the shuffle is the bottleneck when you're executing the SIMD registers. So I just want to know how much of that is a concern.
The statement is, how much is the SIMD shuffle, how much is that a bottleneck, how much is that a concern for what we want to do here versus, like, would it just be better to use quicksort?
Yeah.
We could just run this experiment and try it out. I'm not saying we suggest that. It's my intuition that doing this, even though the shuffle is going to be slightly more expensive, it's definitely going to be way cheaper than quicksort. Because again, it's not just in terms of the number of instructions, it's also the number of branches you have, right? In Quicksort, you're doing these comparisons. You're saying, is this less than this? If the first element is less than that element, write it here, otherwise write it there, right? That causes you to have a slowdown on so the way the sort of Intel's CPUs work now, because they have these really long pipelines. Because if you mispredict the branch, then you have to flush everything and restart it. So it's more than just the instructions, right? It's the fact that there's no conditions at this at all. No matter what values we're inputting, we're going to execute the same instructions every single time. There's no branches at all. That's why it's always going to be faster than Quicksort, even though the shuffle might be more expensive. That's a good point, though. Okay. So for this, again, it looks like the sorting network. But again, these inputs are the locally sorted runs we generated from level one. Or as we get bigger, there'll be the locally sorted runs from previous runs of the level two stuff. So what's going to happen, though, unlike before, where we will actually unlike before, we're just taking the elements and putting them directly into the sorting network. We actually have to do a transformation for half of the input elements into our Bitonic merge network. So the first half of our input would be in the same sort of form that we generated from the previous step, so going from lowest to highest. For the second half, though, we're going to reverse them, so it goes from highest to lowest. And we do this because when we start doing our min and max comparisons, it works out that when we compare like the first element of this for this input will be the highest value, and we compare that with the first element of this list, and it'll be the lowest value. And that makes sure that we're putting things in the right position. So we do sort of one round of this, and then we do more shuffling, do another round of these minimax, more shuffling, and then now we can do just our final comparisons to produce our sorted run. So in this case here, now all these elements, or all these sort of buckets or runs will be globally sorted, going from lowest to highest. And again, we keep doing this until we double the size of our runs until we get to the point where there's half our CPU caches. So after we do this, now we get into the third level. And the idea here is we're in the same way that our level two was sort of building off of level one, level three is sort of building off of level two as well. So now we're going to use these Bitonic merge networks to merge larger sort of runs, but we're going to be careful in how we schedule these operations. So in this example here, say this is one thread doing this, it's just going to rip through and do the min-max, do the shuffle, do the min-max, do the shuffle, right, in that order. But now when we want to start merging really things that exceed our CPU caches, we actually maybe want to jump around to different parts of the execution of these Bitonic merge networks, because we want to have it the case where we can have the memory controller fetch things in the background while we do some processing, rather than blocking and waiting for the memory controller to fetch the things that we need every single time. So the idea here is that we're going to do some extra bookkeeping to know where we can restart at different parts of our pipeline to do this sort merge. But that extra bookkeeping allows us to have more equally distributed consumption of both CPU and memory bandwidth. So the basic idea of what's going to happen here is we're going to use more CPU instructions, but get better performance because the memory controller isn't pushing a ton of data to the registers to your caches and then waiting for the next thing while you can process that. So now we're going to do this. What I'll show you in a second. We're going to do this on a single worker thread per core. And they're going to merge all the data that's local to them. So we're going to run this in parallel on all different cores at the same time, but they're all going to be basically doing the same steps. And because now there's only one thread running in our pipeline, we don't have to do any synchronization on all the intermediate data structures. And that's another reason why this will work out. So it looks sort of like this. So here we have our sorted runs from L2. And again, think of this as a pipeline. Again, we're just combining things together as we go across, and we keep doing all our merging. So in these merge steps are the Bitonic merge networks, and then the outputs are the sorted run. The outputs are going to a queue for the sorted runs, And then once we know that we have enough elements that we want to combine together for these two queues, we can then invoke the next one. So the idea here is that if in the very beginning, since there's nothing for this merge to do because it doesn't have enough inputs in its queue, the system sets a flag to say there's nothing for you to do here. So don't actually try to do anything. So since we're running on a single thread that's doing all of this, there's not like there's a thread spinning here waiting for something to do, or we have to synchronize or send an interrupt for someone to wake up and start doing something. So the thread sort of jumps around all these different parts. So maybe it starts off here and it does a bunch of merging on this, a bunch of merging on that, and then it can start merging on this. But then when this output buffer gets full, you can't merge anything here, so then it'll jump over here and start doing that. So the internal bookkeeping that we're using for all these little different steps allows the thread to know, all right, I have enough data to start merging, or I don't have enough data, so therefore I don't even bother looking in there. And there's no synchronization across different threads because only one thread's doing this. Now you may be thinking, oh, this hurts your CPU caches because maybe I'm over here and I could have, it'd be nice if I could keep this stuff in my pipeline and keep processing it as far as I can, but something, since I had nothing to do, I had to jump here anyway to start processing this. So you do pay a cache miss penalty to do this, but again, that's better than having to block because other threads are, you're waiting for other threads to do writes. So again, so the network I'm showing here is going to be done at every single thread or every single worker thread in the system, and then until we produce our final globally sorted result. All right, so that's how you do sorting, sort of the cache conscious sorting. So now at this point here, we have two globally sorted runs for the entire tables for the input and the outer relations, and then we just do that iteration with the cursor to walk through the two tables and do our comparisons across them. So there's not really much to say about the merge phase algorithm. Depending on how you organize where the data is being stored, as we'll see in a second, you can some threads will have to read data from that's being stored at other threads or other cores. Sometimes you don't, and there's different trade-offs for both of them. But the basic idea is still the same. You still just have to do the straight comparison. So there's no real magic that you can speed this up, other than it's going to be done in parallel across different threads. And if you're careful about how you do this, you don't have to synchronize when you write things out to your output buffers. All right, so the three variants of the sort merge drone algorithms I want to talk about are the multi-way sort merge, the multi-path sort merge, and then the massively parallel sort merge. So these first two come from the ETH paper that you guys read, and then this last one is from the Hyper guys from a few years ago. So the multi-way sort merge is basically everything I just talked about now, with the cache conscious sorting with the three levels, and then you just do the merge at the end. And what happens is you know that all the data at a single core is, the data at the single core for both the inner and the outer relation are enough to do the join. You don't have to look at any other cores, right? I mean, you did this because when you do the level three merging, you actually write things to the core where you think it actually should be. So it sort of looks like this. So you have the outer relation here, and so the first step you're going to do is just sort of the standard NUMA partitioning, whether it's Redis partitioning or whatever other technique you want to use, to then write these out to write the segments of the data that this core is controlled over, to write out those sort of runs here. And this is all done in the local storage. So then now you do the multi-way merge using the level three stuff that I talked about before, where you're now going to have every core knows that the data for some segment of its sort of run should all go to this core, right? And then you can merge now these together using the merge network that I talked about before, with a single thread jumping through and executing the different tasks to do the sorting. All right, so now you do this for every single thread, or every single region they write in a single thread, and then you all do this merging in parallel. All right, so now what you have at every single thread, in total, this is globally sorted, but in each one only knows about the data that it had to sort at this step here. So now on the inner relation, you're going to do basically all the same steps that I showed here. I'm not going to show it because it run out of space, But basically, this sort box here represents all of this stuff here. So now what you have at this point, now you have both for the outer relation and the inner relation, at a single core, you just have the data that you need to do the comparison at this core. So what I mean by that is there's no element or tuple in this, you know, this sorted run here that you have to do a comparison with these other parts here. You can do it all directly local within your core. So you're paying this extra penalty to do all this, to do these remote writes, to do this partitioning in the beginning, but then you don't have to do any of remote reads at this phase here. Right? Again, you just iterate, scan down locally, and do the comparison. So the multipath sort merge is basically the same thing as M-way, except that you don't do any redistribution. You just generate your sorted runs at every single core, and then when you do your scans, you have to look at more stuff. Right? It's basically the same thing here. You just don't do this extra step here. All right. So now with the hyper guys, they're gonna do something much different. So what they're gonna do is you're first gonna do range partitioning over the outer table and redistribute it across the cores in the same way that we saw in the last slide. But then you don't do this for the inner relation. And then at each core and for the outer relation, you just sort them, right? So now you have essentially a globally sorted outer relation. But on the inner relation, you just sort the local data that you have. So then now when you want to do the merge phase, for the inner relation, you're going to have to compare it against all of the, you have to compare one segment to one core, but for all the different segments you have in the interrelation, you may have to go to all the different cores. And so let me show what that looks like. All right, so again, we do essentially just range partitioning, right? Where again, we have to write all the values within a range to the different cores, and then we just sort this locally. And then on the outer relation, we just don't do any redistribution, we just sort the local data that we have. So now when we want to do our merge, say we start with this first segment here, you're going to start off with just the one piece in the range that you know goes to this relation, and then you just do a comparison with the tuples here. So you just do sort of a small scan here, but then the full scan for this entire the entire data set at this core here. All right, and it goes down the line, so every core is going to have to do that same full scan here. And then now for this next one, you do the same thing. Like everyone's going to have to go and look at everything. So this may sound like a bad idea. This may sort of contradict what I said earlier, where you want to avoid having to go over the bus. But the hyper guys are going to argue that when you do these full scans of these blocks here, it's a sequential scan that the hardware prefetcher can accelerate for you. And therefore, you're not doing like a cache miss stall every single time you read anything here. As you scan along, it's going to bring everything you need into your caches over to the core that needs it, and that's going to run really fast. So it's essentially ends up being a local comparison at these cores here, because the hardware prefetcher hit that cost for you. So in the hyper paper, they also provide some rules for what they argue is the correct way to implement the sort merge algorithm, and they get like sort of three edicts that they say matter a lot when you design these algorithms. So the first is that you don't want to have any random writes to non-local memory, and we saw that here, right? Because yes, you have to do this write here to redistribute it, but now when you actually do anything else after this first partitioning, you don't write to any data that's remote. Whereas in the other cases, you did have to merge things around, move things around. The next rule is that if you do a sequential scan on the data that's not local to you, the hardware prefetcher will be able to bring that over for you automatically and hide the access latency of reading things that are far away. And the last one is in sort of what we talked about before with the partitioning or hash join stuff. You never want to have cores synchronized with each other. And so ideally, you want them to be able to operate on the data they have locally and not worry about synchronizing with anybody else, right? So now to do the evaluation from the ETH paper, they're going to implement this, the M-Wave, M-Pass join algorithms that they talk about, as well as the massively parallel sort merge algorithm from the Hyper guys. But then they're also going to implement the radix partitioning hash join that we talked about last class. And this is now going to be running on a newer machine with four sockets, with the Xeons that each have 8 cores, so total would be 4 times 8 would be 32 real cores, and with hyper-threading you have 64 logical cores. And that'll have half a terabyte of DRAM. So the first thing they want to measure is just how does their sort of SIMD accelerated sort compare against the sort of off-the-shelf STL sort that you get from, you know, in C++. So STL sort, I think, does, again, it's a hybrid sort. So they do quick sort in the beginning, and then as you have more sorted runs, then they switch over to heap sort. And so this just shows that their SIMD accelerated sort algorithm is always going to outperform the sort of the STL sort here, right? So it's about 2.5-3x faster. And actually, this almost matches up with what the Intel guys reported, with the speed up you can get using SIMD over SISD instructions. So that's sort of nice. That corroborates that previous finding. So now, when we do a comparison, so they have a synthetic data set, and they're going to be doing, in the outer relation, they'll have 1.6 billion tuples. In the inner relation, there's 128 million tuples. And these tuples are going to be 8 bytes in size. And so what you see here is that the multi-way join, sort merge join algorithm outperforms all the other algorithms. It's actually, the hyper one actually performs the worst. And what you see here is that they're all paying the same partitioning penalty, but the merge phase of the merge join algorithm, yes, I should be clear. So this is the merge of the sorting out phase, and then this is the merge of the join phase. So in the hyper case, even though they claim that the Harvard prefetcher is going to hide that memory access latency problem, you see that they pay a larger penalty here, right? And we're measuring this in terms of the number of cycles, so not the number of instructions, the number of cycles that the CPU spends to execute the algorithm. If you actually now also compare against if you also measure throughput, again you see that the multi-way one outperforms all the other algorithms. So this is just, again, showing you that you're paying an extra cost to do the extra instructions to do all this extra shuffling of data, but with SIMD, it's going to be really, really fast. And in the end, you also reduce the number of cache misses you have because all the data you need is going to be local to you. All right, so another measurement they did was they want to see how these algorithms are affected by hyper-threading. And so, again, they have 64 logical threads, so that means 32 hardware threads, and then in total 64 with hyper-threading. And so what you see is that in this graph here, I'm showing the x-axis on log scale. And so what you want to see is that as you double the number of threads that are processing the join, you want to get double the performance. So you're almost scaling linearly for all these algorithms, except for as you get to these higher core counts, then the hyper algorithm starts to fall off. And then after hyper-threading kicks in, they get actually much worse performance. Right, so this is saying that this case here, you're almost getting linear scale up with the multi-way join until hyper-threading starts, and then, you know, since you're not dealing with real hardware threads, you're not going to get better performance. Right, so in this case here, they can process 315 million tuples per second. And this can only do 105. And again, the main takeaway here is that the extra work we're doing to organize our data pays off in the end. All right, and then this last, for the last comparison, they're going to throw in the radix hash join. Now, I remember, again, I said last class, radix partitioning may not be always the right idea. For this particular workload or this paper, they didn't discuss the no partitioning case. So, again, we have the breakdown between the different phases of the sort merge algorithm, and then I'm combining together the build and probe phase into a single number. So the only one sort of that's worth looking at here is, so across the board, the hash join algorithm always does better, is in this one here that the things actually get relatively close. And what you see is for the radix partitioning stuff, they're spending a ton of time doing the partitioning, in the hash join, because the data sets are huge. Like, you're combining, you know, almost two tables that each have 2 billion tuples. That's a pretty massive join, right? And so in that case, it's not a surprise that the partitioning was going to be the main bottleneck, or the main consumption of CPU for this experiment here. So, all right, and then the last one here, again, they just want to compare against how the algorithms differ when you scale up the number of tuples you're trying to join and your input relations. So again, for smaller tables, the hash join is always going to be better. But then as you come across to the really large table sizes, they essentially become equivalent. And I would argue this is because the hash join is always spending its time doing the partitioning. So it'd be interesting to see what this looks like if you don't do the partitioning. Would this sort of continue to go across? All right. Okay. So I said in the beginning that this doesn't work. Do you want to take a guess why? Actually, before we get there, is there any questions about the sort merge algorithm in general? Okay. So why doesn't this work? So, in all my examples, let's go back to, say, this thing here. What am I sorting? Keys. What's missing? Tuple IDs. Exactly. So, in this, what do we end up with? We end up with a bunch of vectors of, we end up with a bunch of vectors of sorted numbers. Does that help us? No, right? Because we have no idea how to take those numbers and say, oh yeah, that corresponds to tuple 2 and you're tuple 3, right? Well, all we did was just sort numbers here, right? So the reason why this doesn't work is because I'm not including the tuple IDs. And in a in-memory system, database system, we're going to have 64-bit tuple IDs, right? Because otherwise, we can only have 2 to the 32 tuples in a table. And that's, you know, clearly showed examples where we want to be in the billions, and that's not going to work. So how would you actually store the tuple IDs to do this? Right? How would you take that, like, in case of the sorting network? How would you include the tuple IDs? You could do something really stupid. You could say, like, all right, well, I know I have values 1, 2, 3, 4. Those are the keys I'm sorting. And I have tuple 1 and has value 1, tuple 2, value 2. So then when I get the data out of the SIMD register that's sorted, I can then go back and look and say, oh yeah, this is value 4. That's tuple, you know, tuple this tuple. Right? That's terrible, right? That would be super slow and defeats the whole purpose of SIMD. So the way you would have to do this is that you actually have to pack in the tuple ID with the value. So you would have the first upper bits of the record of the value be the join key, and then the last 64 bits will be the tuple ID, right? And again, in that case, again, the sorting stuff all still works because the it's that first part of the value we're sorting that's always going to be how we're going to determine whether one value is better than, you know, higher than another. So it doesn't matter whether the tuple ID is less or lower, it's the upper part of the value that we're going to end up being sorted on. So now, I said before that we have to make sure that we have aligned values. So that if we have a 32-bit tuple, there's a 32-bit value with 64-bit tuple IDs, we can't pack them together in a 96-bit value. We have to pad it out to be 128 bits. But the problem is, everything that I showed before, the reason why it doesn't work is because current Xeon processors only have 256-bit SIMD registers. So that means you can only store two values, 128-bit values that are comprised of the join key and the tuple ID together in the register. And then that's essentially useless for us, right? In the sorting network example I showed, we need to sort four values. So this does. So none of this actually works. And you'll see this in the paper we read next week from Columbia. They assume that they have four byte tuple IDs, right? that everything fits in sort of single 64-bit words. But that's not, again, not real in a real system. So the reason why I say, I want to be clear that it's the Xeon general purpose CPUs and not the Phi, because the Xeon general purpose CPUs only have AVX 256. The Xeon Phi has 512. So you can store four 128-bit values in their SIMD registers here. So you can do everything we talked about here using the Xeon Phi, but you can't do this in the regular Xeons. Now, the Xeon Phi we'll talk about next class, but think of it as like a, think of it like in the original version of it, it was like it would be on the PCI Express bus, right? You'd have this like, it wasn't like a GPU, you could plug it into, you know, you could drive the graphics for your monitor. It was just a coprocessor that only could crunch numbers and send data back to the CPU. So it's going to have the same problem that we talked about before with GPUs. We have to send data down for the PCI Express bus, then let it do the sorting, and then move the data back up to the CPU, which again is going to be bad and slow. I will say there's newer versions of the Xeon Phi, I think as it came out last year, where you actually can plug it directly into the socket, and you have it can be cache coherent with the other CPUs. But again, most people don't have that. If you go on Amazon, you don't get that on EC2. So it's actually pretty rare. So again, I think this is important to discuss because it's an interesting use of SIMD, but it just doesn't work. And I had a student implement it last semester, and we measured it just doesn't work. So it's a bad implementation, but we sort of implement it because we know that when they finally add 512-bit registers to Xeons, we can then use it. So this is why I'm saying I think that when the Xeons get updated and finally support 512-bit registers, sort merge actually might then outperform hash joins. But we have ways to go. Okay, so what are my parting thoughts on this? So even though I just told you that everything I talked about today doesn't actually work, it's still important to actually have both join algorithms. Even if you can't accelerate the sort merge one, there may be cases where you actually want to choose that over the hash join. And the reason is because sometimes queries want the data sorted, right? If you have an order by clause that wants to sort your data based on the join key, then the sort merge join, although it's not going to be hardware accelerated, is going to be better than the hash join because the data will just automatically be sorted when you complete the join and you don't have to go do an extra round of sorting. Whereas in the hash join, because it's being hashed, the data is basically completely random, and then you have to do additional sorting. So this is why every major database system that wants to support complex analytics will actually support both algorithms, because the optimizer can then choose to one implementation over another. Right. So in everything we talk about here, it's just talking about the algorithms running in isolation. But in a real system, you have to understand it's a really complex query that has a lot of different dependencies, and you may want to choose one of these algorithms versus another. And even if you don't want to do a join, if you just want to do an order by on an entire table, then if you had, again, the hardware accelerated sort merge, you could rely on that technique to speed things up as well. Right? Because you don't need the merge phase, you just need the sorting phase. All right. So in our current system, we support hash join. I think we have a sort merge. I don't know how well tested it actually is, but again, most systems will have both. All right. So for next class, we're actually going to be discussing a really interesting topic that's really important called code generation. And what I'll say is that it's actually code gen will actually get you a much better improvement over performance over the SIMD stuff that we'll talk about afterwards. I'm actually debating whether maybe you want to spread out the CodeGen stuff to maybe cover two lectures, because the vectorized stuff is now scheduled for two things, but I might steal some extra time from one lecture and talk more about CodeGen, because it makes a big difference in performance. The other thing, again, just as a reminder for everyone here, the first code review you're going to have to do for project number 3 will be scheduled for April 11th. And so again, the code review has two parts. There's you getting your code ready for your group you're being assigned to provide them your code so that they can look over. And then after that, you'll have a week to look over the code that they give you and provide them feedback about how their implementation is going. So obviously you need something to show to somebody else Because if you give them nothing, then that's bad for you and sort of waste everyone's time. So you should be mindful that this is deadline's coming up in less than 2 weeks, and you have to be ready to turn your code over to the other team. And I'll send out an email this weekend about who you're going to be paired up with. And so this is why when you look at the spreadsheet on Google Docs for the class, there's a column that says put your GitHub URL for your project, because that way I know how to sign. The other team will know where to look. Okay? Any questions? All right, guys. Have a good weekend, and I will see you.